We're not gonna have it. This is something that we're. Hey, more birthday boy. Happy birthday.
Thank you.
Happy birthday?
I did.
Yeah, you go to dinner tonight, cause we had.
You did birthday present last night?
Yes.
Well, Paul and Santa went, so we know.
Yeah.
Try to call.
So we have three kids. Reference and family.
We try.
To say the least. This is presenting, she's new, she just moved here. That game last night is why I'm sleepy this morning, cause I kept thinking they would put it away, and they never did. Kept staying up and staying up. It's a good game. Yeah. It was a lot closer than I thought it was gonna be.
My best friend and I are down there. They come up and that's what I'm there, so we had a wonderful time. But then y'all there several years ago.
I'm hoping it's one more year. That was strong. That was strong. We had some friends over who were moving here from Washington. He was in my law school class. And the point of this is the reason the game is that his daughter was once. But he was in my law school class at Vanderbilt in the 80s, and we've been friends for 4 years, and they're retiring here. But he's retiring sooner than he thought because he's the assistant general counsel to the Secretary of Defense until January 20th, because he lost his job. It was an election. So they were over at our house last night, and they literally just moved from Washington yesterday. And so they came over, and you know, I thought I had it all set up, it's gonna be great, you know, and we were flipping out by halftime because it was open. I mean, they blew their doors off. It was strong. But anyway. They play like that, they'll take it in. Yeah, of course.
Of course.
Of course.
In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. Luke chapter 1, chapter 2, verse 1 through 3 and 4. Sorry.
Today we remember Joseph, worn out traveler and worried husband, doing what was necessary for the sake of his family with an undying trust in the promise of God. There was no room for him, yet he knows to whom he belongs.
Today we give thanks for the Josephs among us, migrating far from home when there is no choice, fiercely devoted to the ones they love, unwavering in their belief that God has room for all of us in his kingdom.
On this fourth Sunday of Advent, we light this candle as a symbol of Joseph who knocks at the door, ready to take his place among royalty. Today we light the fourth candle, the candle of love.
Good Please stand now as our service continues. Please stand as we sing. For the lessons.
First lesson this morning is from the 7th chapter of the prophet Isaiah, found in your bulletin, page 4. Again, the Lord spoke to Ahaz, "Ask a sign of the Lord your God. Let it be deep as Sheol or high as heaven." But Ahaz said, "I will not ask, and I will not put the Lord to the test." And he said, "Hear then, O house of David, is it too little for you to weary men, that you weary my God also? Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. He shall eat curds and honey when he knows how to refuse the evil and choose the good. For before the boy knows how to refuse the evil and choose the good, the land whose two kings you dread will be deserted. The Lord will bring upon you and upon your people and upon your father's house such days as have not come since the day that Ephraim departed from Judah, the king of Assyria." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Spark lesson this morning. A child called Emmanuel. Page 168 of the Spark Bible. Page 168 in the Spark Bible. A child called Emmanuel.
A child called Emmanuel. King Ahaz, the king of Judah, would not listen to God. He wanted to become friends with people from another country who didn't believe in God. God knew this was a bad idea because the people in the other country really wanted to hurt King Ahaz and his people. God pleaded. King Ahaz would not change his mind. He wanted his own way. "Ask me for a sign," God said. "Then you will know that I am your God. Then you will listen to me." God sent a prophet, Isaiah, to talk with King Ahaz. Isaiah did what God asked him to do. His job was to be God's voice. Isaiah warned King Ahaz that bad things would happen to him and his people. If he did not listen to God, Isaiah promised that God would protect King Ahaz and his country if he listened. God even gave King Ahaz a sign to look for a child to show him the way. Isaiah said a child would be born and live with the people. His name would be Emmanuel. Emmanuel means God with us. Then the people would know how much God loved them and they would listen to God. King Ahaz crossed his arms and shook his head. "Who is Isaiah to tell him what to do?" "I'm the king," King Ahaz said. "People listen to me. Why should I listen to you or your God, Isaiah?" King Ahaz did not listen to God, and soon things went very bad for King Ahaz. His crops dried up. There's very little food. Soon his country was taken over by others. Other people, the Israelites, did listen to Isaiah. They remembered God's promise and waited many years for God's sign, Emmanuel, to be born. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. We stand now as we sing, "Angels We Have Heard on High."
Oh,
Gospel lesson is found in the Pew Bibles, page 1053, in the Pew Bibles, page 1053, the first chapter of John. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Glory to you, Lord Christ. Gospel lesson begins at verse 6 with the preamble. Verse 6. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. Continuing now at verse 19, this is the testimony given by John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny it, but he confessed, "I am not the Messiah." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Then they said to him, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" John said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah said." Now they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him, "Why then are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah nor Elijah nor the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandals." This took place in Bethany across the Jordan, where John was baptizing. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ.
The Lord be with you.
With your spirit.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. The topic of the sermon today is humility, and I want to begin with talking a moment of something we can all agree upon, what humility is not. Humility is not vanity. That is inflated pride in oneself or one's appearance. Most people might think that the opposite of humility is pride and vanity. It's that egotistic attitude that is consumed by the thoughts of oneself and looks. These people tend to think that everything centers around them. What humility is not, it's not forgetting your worth. It's been said, humility is not thinking less of yourself, it is thinking of yourself less. So humility does not mean that you hate who you are or what you look like. It does not mean believing you are worthless. Humility means recognizing other people's worth and talents. And it also means recognizing your own gifts and worth. Humility is not jealousy and envy. Humble people do not resent other people's achievements and acts of virtue, nor do they rejoice in others' misfortune, failures, or sin. So secondly, let's talk about what humility is. And through the years, you may have learned or thought of humility as being a variety of different things. But today I want to suggest a simple understanding of humility. And that is, humility is to know one's place. What one's place is not, in relationship to God and in relationship to others, and what one's place is in relationship to God and in relationship to others. Now we're going to look this morning at John the Baptist. in the gospel reading as someone who exemplifies humility. First of all, he knows who he is not. And that's in response to the questions asked by the Jews sent from the Pharisees, "Who are you?" And his response is, "I am not the Christ." First, he knows he's not the Messiah, and he confessed and did not deny, but confessed, "I am not the Christ." Then they ask him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" And he said, "I am not." Why Elijah? Well, they believed that Malachi prophesied that Elijah would return before the Messiah comes. Malachi 4, 5, and 6 reads, "Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the great and awesome day of the Lord comes, and he will turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the hearts of children to their fathers, lest I come and strike the land with a decree of utter destruction." Based on this scripture and the fact that Elijah never died but was taken up into heaven, there was a prevailing belief that Elijah would be brought down to earth again when the Messiah returned. But John said, "I am not Elijah." Finally, the Jew says, "Are you the prophet?" And John said, "No, I am not the prophet." This is a reference to Deuteronomy 8:15, when Moses said, "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you, from your brothers. It is to him you shall listen, just as you desired of the Lord your God at Horeb on the day of the assembly when you said, 'Let me not hear again the voice of the Lord my God or see this great fire any more, lest I die.' And the Lord said to me, 'They are right in what they have spoken. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their brothers, and I will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak to them all that I command him.'" So in exemplifying humility, John the Baptist knows who he is not. He is not the Christ. He is not Elijah. He is not the prophet. What would you and I say in regard to our lives about humility? Do we know our proper place? Do we know who we are not? First of all, Scripture says we are not more important than other people. And that's hard sometimes to live by. We are not important, more important than other people. James chapter 2 says, "Show no partiality, no favoritism, and do not be a respecter of persons." Now, a respecter of persons is someone who treats people according to their rank, status, or importance. Now, I'm guilty of being a respecter of persons. I just, you know, the bishop walks in and, you know, I just want to kneel down and kiss his ring. But, I'm reminded twice I went uptown to get tested for COVID. Both were negative. And there was a man, raggedy dressed, on the side of the road asking for money. And I gave him money. But I must confess, I respect other people more than him. And James clearly says that is a sin. Do not be a respecter of persons. Do we tend to do that or not? Do we tend to seek our own happiness, acting as though the world revolves around us? I remember Billy Graham saying that the root sins are selfishness, self-centeredness, and believing that the world revolves around me. You know, we have a tradition at our house of having a lot of gifts. And the family comes together and we each take turn with each person opening the gift. So the more gifts, the merrier. So when I ordered my January 2021 calendar, I wrapped it up and put it under the tree so I could have another gift. And the card I wrote says, to Joe, from Joe, paid for by Joe, wrapped by Joe, and put under the tree by Joe, because it's all about Joe. You know, I try to add a little bit of humor to Christmas. Think about service here in the church. We do a lot of service for other people. How much time do we spend in service to other people? How much of our purpose, thoughts, and actions contain an eternal perspective? And these types of questions help us take inventory of our hearts and minds. So point one, John is asked, who are you? And he responds, who he is not. He is not the Christ. He is not the prophet. He is not Elijah. So then they say again, well then, who are you? And he responds this time, who he is. He said, I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord, as Isaiah the prophet said. And he's quoting a scripture from Isaiah 40, chapter 3. He is paving the way of the Lord for others to come to Christ. And a question might be, or a suggestion might be to you and me, that you and I individually can be like John the Baptist in paving the way of the Lord for someone else. You know, Jesus' great commission at the end was to say to his disciples, go into all the world and make disciples of all peoples, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. So how can we pave the way of the Lord for someone who does not know Christ? We can do that by developing a relationship. Well, maybe we already have a relationship with them at work or in our neighborhood or in our family. But we can nurture that relationship. Maybe bring up the topic of Christianity and spiritual matters. Show them the love of Christ. And that would be paving the way like John the Baptist did. So in talking about humility, I thought about a common, a not uncommon malady that strikes many homes and families, which is alcoholism. And I know that the families and loved ones of alcoholics can go to a support group called Al-Anon. And this about humility is an entry from the book Courage to Change, which is used by Al-Anon. I used to live my life as if I were on a ladder. Everyone was either above me to be feared and envied, or below me to be pitied. God was way, way at the top beyond my view. That was a hard, lonely way to live. When I came to Al-Anon, I found a lot of people who had decided to climb down from their ladders into the circle of fellowship. In the circle, we were all on equal terms, and God was right there in the center, easily accessible. And I think about our church when I read this. We are all on equal terms, and God is in the center, easily accessible to all of us. When newcomers arrived and we didn't worry about rearranging everyone's position, we simply widened the circle. Today, I no longer look up to some people and down on others. I can look each person in the eye squarely and honestly. Today, being humble means climbing down the ladder of judgment of myself and others and taking my rightful place. Real humility is the ability to see my true relationship to God and to my fellow human beings. Let me conclude by briefly talking about the twofold directions of humility. First is vertical. In our relationship with God, James 4 says, "But he gives more grace. Therefore, it says, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble." Also, humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will exalt you. And then there's the second horizontal dimension of humility to others. Philippians 2:3 says, "Do nothing from selfishness or conceit, but in humility count others better than yourselves." Amen.
Let's stand now and affirm our faith in the words of the Creed, counting the bulletins, page 7. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is and is holy and invisible. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us offer our prayers to God. Lord God, we thank you for the leaders of our church, especially Archbishop Beach, Bishop Lawrence, Bishop Skilton, Father Marshall, Father Donnie, Father Joe, Father David, and our staff, and we ask you to bless them. We also pray for St. Andrew's Mission and their vicar, Father Jimmy Gallant. Lord God, we pray for all those who proclaim the gospel at home and abroad, and for all who teach and disciple others, in particular for All Saints Church in Florence, Director, Father Jason Hamshaw, Chelsea, and their family. For San Jose Church in the Dominican Republic, Director, Father Sandino Sanchez, and their Bishop, Moises Quezada. And for Father Rob Sturdy, Anglican chaplain at the Citadel. Lord God, we pray for the leaders of our country, especially President Trump, Governor McMaster, Mayor Tecklenburg, and we ask you to bless them. Lord God, we thank you for all our blessings, especially for people who love and care for us. Lord God, we ask you to take care of everyone who is sick or sad.
Especially Father Donnie McDaniel, Kevin Wolf and Hannah, Susie Compton, Brian Ishmael, Isaac Nettles, and all that we name aloud with solemnly in our hearts at this time.
Lord God, we know you hear us when we pray. We ask that you answer our prayers as may be best for us.
And now, kneeling, let us humbly confess our sins to Almighty God. Lord God, for all the times I have disappointed you, I am truly sorry. For all the mean or selfish things I have done, I am truly sorry. For the good and helpful things I have not done, I am truly sorry. For not loving you or other people as I should, I am truly sorry. Because Jesus died for my sins, forgive me and help me be more faithful. Lord, hear our prayer. God tells us in the Bible that if we are sorry for our sins and turn from them, he will forgive us. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, bring you to everlasting life. Amen. Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you and with your spirit. Greet one another now in the name of our Lord.
Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to those worshiping with us online. Welcome to you today who are here. And just a few announcements for you this morning. First of all, the poinsettias for Christmas. These green forms are out on your pews. Those of you watching online, if you would like to dedicate a poinsettia in memory of someone, please contact the church office tomorrow by noon. For those of you here today, please fill those out if you'd like to do one, and you may leave that in the offering plate today. Communion will be from your pews from now on until further notice, and we want to heighten our safety here, and I'm glad to report Father Donnie is much better, and no one on the staff, clergy, have come down with COVID. We've been tested twice this week, and thanks be to God, Donnie is better now. But in the interest of safety, we will be receiving communion at the benches for the next several Sundays until further notice. After the service today, on your way out, I hope you'll stop at the Dominican flag that's there in the back of the church. Today is the final day for our raffle to benefit San Jose Church in the DR for those students there who attend university. For the many needs that that church in that community has in that very poor area of the Dominican Republic. Tickets are $50 a piece. We've sold about 75 tickets now, and that is for an amazing weekend at Kiowa for up to four people with dinner and spa treatments, a pretty great package to receive. The drawing will be today at 12:30, so I encourage you to support our mission efforts in the DR. By buying at least one ticket for $50 on your way out today. Also today at 3 o'clock is the King's Counterpoint Christmas Concert online. And that's at 3 o'clock today. That will be live streamed, and I commend that to you as well. Services for Christmas Eve at 2 o'clock, 4, 7, and 11. And at 4 o'clock, the 4 o'clock service, there will be an additional seating, if you will, in Gilchrist Hall, along with communion offered over there for that 4 o'clock service. All four of the services on Christmas Eve will be the same format. And then our Christmas Day service will be at 10:30 here in the church. So, a big week coming up for us here at Old St. Andrews. After the service today, we will not be having Sunday school today. We will offer refreshments over in the parish hall. CDs are on sale over there as well. Come on over and have some fellowship and some refreshments before you head home today. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself an offering and sacrifice to God. Amen.
Because you sent your beloved Son to redeem us from sin and death.
and make us heirs to him of everlasting life, that when he shall come again in power and great glory to judge the world, we may without shame or fear rejoice to behold his appearing. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Thank you.
for those of you watching from home who do not have access to the consecrated bread and wine. Dear Jesus, I believe that you are truly present in the Holy Sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to possess you within my soul. And since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, I beseech you to come spiritually into my heart. I unite myself to you, together with all your faithful people gathered around every altar of your church. And I embrace you with all the affections of my soul. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
I'm
Father, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, the honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Peace to God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and the Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. The blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you this day, this Advent and Christmas season, and always. Amen. Amen. We stand now as we sing.
Hallelujah.